How's everybody doing out there? This is Philip Muhammad. I'm here at the home of Queen Mother Blakely, Dr. Delois Blakely. And we are here to discuss with her history here at her home and some of the amazing facts that bring us to the realization that we as a people are under attack. And we really need to do something to protect our elders, whose homes are in jeopardy because of a lack of understanding and a lack of unity amongst those who would normally, by nature, be the protectors of our elders. Mother Blakely, could you tell us a little bit about yourself, about your history, and how did you become Queen Mother Blakely?
Well, I am Queen Mother Dr. Delois Blakely, and I'm the Community Mayor of Harlem. I'm also the Ambassador of Goodwill to Africa, and I have been involved with the community for about 50 years. I'm an elder now, and I've been quite active within our community. I carry the legacy of Queen Mother Moore, who fought for reparation, and she said the greatest crime ever committed against the people has been the slave trade of the transatlantic ocean of the slave trade. And as you know, of the Middle Passage, Queen Mother said the greatest crime is that, and the world owes us reparation. And in that spirit, and before, which I was a Roman Catholic nun for 10 years, working in our community, and God has allowed me to dedicate my life, not only in Harlem, but throughout the world. When I'm not in Harlem, I'm in Africa. And Queen Mother received her title from the late king of the Ashanti Kingdom of Ghana, West Africa, in the Ashanti Kingdom, as I said before, in Kumasi. And the legacy has been passed to me where I have met with the king that sits on the stool today. And in coming to the United States, and before he came, President Jerry Rawlings of Ghana at that time, and Nana Rawlings, his wife, made sure that they sojourned here to Harlem to spend time with Queen Mother. But I had the honor of spending time with the oldest Queen Mother of that area and of that kingdom, the Ashanti Kingdom, which her son sits on the golden stool today. And in meeting with his mother made it clear that I was a Queen Mother in my own right, and not just carrying the legacy as the Queen Mother, but in my own right. She gave me 3 assignments, and I fulfilled the last assignment when Barack Obama, the president today, went to Ghana. I was there. I also was commissioned by the ancestors to spend 3 days and 3 nights in the Cape Coast dungeons, which you call the castle, the Cape Coast castles, and that was a spiritual journey unknown to me. And in Ghana, where I was on my way to South Africa, I never arrived in South Africa because I was snatched. Spiritually, you can be snatched against your will. And when I could not leave the country at the airport, when I went to leave to go to South Africa for Nelson Mandela inauguration, I was stopped and I was told that I never entered the country. So I had to reflect. And as you know, that many of the refugees come through Ghana from Liberia. So I was told I was a Liberian, and I had no passport to be able to explain to anyone that I was not a Liberian. Having an American passport means nothing to anyone when you are captured.
Right.
When you're captured in a country, they don't know if somebody gave you the passport, a false passport, because of my features are so strong, which the ancestors and the God force has allowed me to remain an African woman, a woman that comes out of the Middle Passage, a woman that comes out of the mother of civilization. It's not a discussion, but God has endowed my broad features to remain. When you think of the rape of our women, and I would say that my ancestors must have jumped overboard. And in North Africa, or in Egypt, I was told in the Nile that I was Queen Hatshepsut. I ruled as a great king, but I was a woman dressed in order to rule as a woman, because you did not have women ruling the way Queen Hatshepsut ruled. So I was given that long time ago on my first trip to Egypt. So in carrying the ancestors' energy, and I set up her tombs in Egypt, I understand who I am from that energy and from the spiritual energy of moving across the continent. The continent is my second home, which I have roamed the continent of Mother Africa for about 40 years. But the woman who started me on the journey of the Sikh of my royalty was a woman by the name of Dr. Angie Brooks at the United Nations, a woman who we would consider rule as an iron woman. She was the president of the General Assembly. And when you think of Liberia, the first woman president of Liberia, Sirleaf Johnson, she had the same godmother, the same mentor that I had at the United Nations for about 40 years. So my protocol and understanding placed me into royalty through the bloodline and through the pigmentation and through what I look like. I am the picture of Mother Africa. Just look at my broad features.
Yes.
And seeing my broad feature is never a question of do I belong to Africa, that I'm an African child. But the question is, where about in Africa? As I went from border to border as a Fulbright scholar in Tanzania with Mwalimu Julius Nyerere as my godfather, which he was the head of state in Tanzania, and as a Fulbright scholar, going from border to border, everyone thought that I just refused to speak the language, the tribal languages, but they didn't know I could not. I had been robbed of my languages, my culture, my bloodline, my energy, my spirituality, my tradition, my culture, my name bearing of my family from whence I come. So I was a daughter who's seeking the road of Africa for me. So I have claimed all of Africa as the true home for me as a daughter of Africa. So when they ask me, where do I come from? I tell them, Africa. The whole continent belongs to me in the spirit of my ancestors. And so with that, that is what I claim. As I move through Africa, in many kingdoms in Africa, as Queen Mother, and I've been given many names in many kingdoms.
Can you tell us a little bit about your recent history and your relationship with Queen Mother Moore?
Well, Queen Mother Moore grabbed at me, I'll never forget, at the United Nations. As I said, that my journey to the UN happened because of member states such as Nigeria and Liberia and Tanzania. They embraced me as a daughter of Africa when I left the convent. My first clothes, culture clothes, came directly from the member states of Africa. And from then on, it's sort of like they embraced me and thought that I was a child who wandered away from our people, maybe going to school in America. But as little as they got to know that I was born in America against my will. So I carry the energy of Africa. And so when Queen Mother Moore first met me at the UN, and I was robed in my African clothes, she couldn't get over it. So she was like, my child, where are you from? You're so beautiful. And then I had to explain to her that I came from the deep south. And then when I told her the story where I was born as a Gator girl, she never believed it. Then she asked me that I had to come to her side and work with her. And so as an elder, I had to drop everything, and I went to the side of Queen Mother Moore, and I was at her side for about 20 years.
And when
at
did
the
it
time
start?
That she least needed me, in the I would say in the late 70s, and then throughout the 80s and 90s, and moving to the 2000s, I was with Queen Mother Moore on this journey.
I remember her. It seemed like every time she came to an event, I was one of the brothers in the nation that was right there, and I would always see you and her together, and you assisting her to everywhere she needed to go. So, in my opinion, you have earned your right to be the new queen here in Harlem and throughout the world of Africa. you know, as an ambassador. And I need to ask you this as well, the New Future Foundation, at what point did you bring that, did that actually come about, the New Future Foundation? Can you tell us a little bit about how that became, and also where is it now? Where is it now in the future?
The New Future Foundation is 40 years old. Mm-hmm. I started in 1968. I was a Roman Catholic nun for 10 years, and I left the convent. And I'm sure you heard of Sister Act 1 and 2.
Right.
That comes, yes, that comes out of my life, which I am now in search, that letting no one rob me of my life. It seems that, I guess, my position or my attitude in life has allowed people to constantly come to snatch from me. But there are certain things that the Creator would not allow others to take from you, even if they try. Even if they have made more than a quarter of billions of dollars, or I would say $6 billion off my life of telling that story, that's something that I wrote. And one morning you woke up because you did not have the resources that people think they can take from you and keep. So there again, I'm finding that that has been a pattern in my life. Being in a convent at the age of 16 and made fine of vows, and not coming from Catholicism, but come out of the tradition. Most of us come out of Christianity, mm-hmm. and we come out of the Baptist Church, or we come out of the Methodist Church, most of us. Mm-hmm. And my family came out of the Baptist Church of Christianity. And when, at a young age, I was in search of being a missionary. I wanted to be a doctor, mm-hmm. and I wanted to be a medical doctor that would be on missions. So I come from godparents who were medical doctors in the Deep South, but also I wanted to serve God. From a child, I had this strong attraction to God, and I guess I have been destined by God to have the strong attraction, because I don't think it's something I could have made up on my own as a child, mm-hmm. in this search for this spirituality. And so with the Catholicism allowed that to happen for me to leave home to be a Roman Catholic nun for 10 years. I left home at the age of 16 years old. But the yearning and search for God started when I was about 14 years old. So strong that I wanted to leave school, and I left school. But I left school and I entered the convent. And they accepted me against, usually they take in girls when they're 18 years old. Mm-hmm. They took me in when I was 16 underage, so that my parents had to give me permission to do so because I was underage. And they allowed it to happen. And I guess it had something to do with my a way of behavior and the way I constantly presented myself to the society as a child. And I was always dedicated and committed to others and servicing others. So my parents did not see this as a bad thing of going into a convent, mm-hmm. but they knew nothing about a convent.
Where was this convent? And you meant also, you mentioned that this story, the story was taken from you. Could you get into a little bit more detail as to how the story was acquired from your possession?
Well, I had a literary agent. Usually when I left the convent,
which was where?
I left the convent, I stayed in the convent for 10 years, made fine vows. That's the highest you can go in a convent, is making fine vows. Mm-hmm. The church make a decision whether they want you or not during the period of I would say 10 years, when you're in a process of becoming a nun. And becoming a nun, it's a period of time.
Right.
It's more than like becoming a medical doctor. Mm-hmm. And so in the midst of that process of the 10 years, they make a decision that they want you during that process, or you want them. Mm-hmm. And then there are certain times you can opt out. And there are certain times they would make sure that you opt out before you went to the next level. Mm-hmm.